good time every Thursday evening. So anybody's interested, just come on over at 7 o'clock. This is this takes place in the garden of Gethsemane, just as Jesus had done. Start with a sense of theme. We're going to talk about angels today. Has anyone here ever seen an angel? Anyone think an angel ever intervened on their behalf? Maybe helped them out? I don't think I've actually seen an angel, but I think there may have been times that angels have helped me out. I'm sure we can all think of times when, unexplainably, we were sure something bad was going to happen, and it didn't. Or out of nowhere, we got the solution to a problem, or an event that we were involved with. Angels are mentioned in the Bible nearly 300 times. They play a big role in both the Old and the New Testaments. Here are some facts that are found in the Bible. Angels were created by God. Paul tells us in Colossians 1, verse 16, that all things were created by God, visible and invisible. Angels are innumerable. In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus said he could call 12 legions of angels. Now, assuming that a Roman legion was somewhere between 4,000 and 6,000 men, that could be as many as 72,000 angels. In Revelation, we read, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000. Got my calculator out for that one. That's 100 million. Too many to count. The word angel literally means messenger. The Greek word is actually angelos, which means messenger, envoy. God directs his angels. He has used, and I believe he's still using, angels as messengers, destroyers, protectors, emissaries, etc. Angels are neither male or female. They do not marry. They don't procreate. All angels are created by God. Angels are very powerful creatures. One angel slew 185,000 Assyrians in one day. There are good angels and bad angels. We learn from scriptures that Lucifer, a very powerful and beautiful angel, probably an archangel, was jealous of God and tried to wrest power over the universe from God. The archangel Michael and the rest of the royal angels fought the traitors and banished them from heaven. We now refer to Lucifer as Satan and his followers as demons. At the resurrection, at Christ's coming, people will be like angels in heaven. Angels rejoice whenever one person repents and accepts Jesus Christ as their Savior. However, angels do not evangelize. They advise humans. They bring messages to humans. They help put humans in the right place to spread God's word, but they do not evangelize. Only Christians who have known sin and salvation through Jesus Christ, are equipped to spread that message. The angels can praise God for many things, but they cannot sing redeemed by the blood. So they're not. And like I said, angels are mentioned in the Bible almost 300 times. Let's look at some of these instances and see what angels do on behalf of God, sometimes directly for us. In our Old Testament reading today, we heard about how an angel sent by God closed the mouth of the lions. We didn't read the next part. The king had the accusers of Daniel thrown into the lion's den. And those accusers only lasted seconds before the lion was on the court. How about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? King Nebuchadnezzar had them thrown into the fiery furnace that was heated 7 times hotter than what they formerly had. In this case, not only were Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego protected, but the king could see a fourth person walking around in the fire with him. So the king was able to witness the angel of the Lord ministering to them. Of course, we all know the Christmas story, all the events before and after the nativity. Angels brought messages to Zechariah, to Mary, to Joseph, the shepherds, the wise men. Hosts of angels, thousands, joined in and proclaimed the birth of Christ to the shepherds. We also read of Philip being directed by an angel to go out into the desert where he meets the Ethiopian eunuch. The Ethiopian had been reading the book of Isaiah and he got to the part that prophesied Jesus' death. Really wasn't understanding it. So he asked Philip to explain it to him. Philip presented the good news of Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection. The Ethiopian became a Christian right there. He was baptized. But notice, the angel did not do the evangelizing. He directed Philip to the place and the opportunity to do that. It was Philip that told the good news of Christ. Now there's a parable in Luke about a rich man and a beggar. The beggar's name was Lazarus. When the rich man died, he got what he deserved, an eternity of agony and separation from God. But upon death, Lazarus was carried to heaven and to God's presence by the angels. There have been lots of questions surrounding this. Do angels carry all Christians to heaven upon their death? Other than parables like this one, there's no biblical answer to that question. But many scholars, biblical scholars, believe the answer is yes. I like the way Billy Graham explains it. He refers to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2. And he says, at the moment of death, the spirit departs from the body and moves through the atmosphere. But the scripture teaches us that the devil dwells there. And here's the scripture passage. Satan is the prince of the power of the air. If the eyes of our understanding were open, we would probably see the air filled with demons, the enemies of Christ. Now, since the angels are continually making that journey between heaven and earth, who better to protect us from being hijacked? Hijacked by Satan on that final journey from here to heaven. Now these are all evidences that we have from the Bible, and there are many, many more. I said there were 300 mentions of angels, or almost 300 mentions of angels. And most of us accept these as truths. But it becomes more challenging to accept stories we hear that are not part of the Bible. If we're to look for evidence of how angels work in our lives today, we must entertain the possibility that some, at least some of the stories we hear are true. So I've compiled a few here that appear to have more merit than some of the others we might hear. John G. Patton is a Scottish missionary and minister from the middle to the end of the 19th century. After graduation from seminary, he and his wife traveled to the New Hebrides Islands in Southeast Asia. At that time, there were still some pretty fierce tribes living there. Some of them were even cannibals. The Pattons lived and ministered in constant fear. But one night, after several weeks of threats from one tribe in particular, the Pattons woke to hear a huge commotion outside. It was obvious to them that the tribe was coming to make good on their threats. The Pattons immediately started praying. After about an hour, they started seeing bright lights all around their house. They thought that they were soon going to be burned alive. They kept praying all night long. When daylight finally arrived, they found that the hostile tribe were gone. Nothing around the house had been harmed. About a year later, the chief of that tribe accepted Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior, and he received salvation. Then, John decided he's got to know. He asked the chief the question that was still burning in his mind. Why didn't you kill us that night? We tried, said the chief, but the guards wouldn't let us pass. John said, what guards? The chief waved his arms dramatically. Hundreds of guards, big men in shiny clothes, with swords drawn. They circled your hut. We had no choice, so we left. Sounds a little bit like an Old Testament. Moving a little closer to the present, Charles Lindbergh reported that during his historic transatlantic flight, there were times he could barely stay awake. At one point, during those times, he witnessed beatings all around his plane. They were accompanying him and keeping him safe from his own exhaustion. He could only credit them as being angels. There were lots of reports during World War II. One of the stories that I found really interesting was about the British Air Force. In the early stages of the war, the British Air Force saved England from invasion by the Germans. The Air Chief Marshal, Lord Hugh Dowling, said that their men were operating on almost no sleep. The planes were flying continually. He told of airmen that had been killed and incapacitated, but the planes kept on fighting. Other pilots reported that on occasion they could see figures in the planes operating the controls. The Air Chief Marshal said he believed that angels actually flew the planes in which the pilots were dead. Billy Graham tells the story of a group of Marines who had become lost up north during the Korean War. Dreadfully cold, way below freezing. They'd been without food for for 6 days and were considering surrender. Well, one of them was a Christian and taught them to sing the song of praise. Shortly thereafter, they heard a great ruckus. They thought the enemy had found who was attacking. But when they looked, a large boar was running straight at them, trying to get out of the way. It suddenly stopped, just short of running them over. Now, as one of the soldiers started to aim his rifle at that boar, he just dropped over dead. They ate well that evening. The next morning, a young South Korean who spoke English found them and said he could lead them back. When they finally got back to territory they recognized, they turned to thank the young man. He had disappeared. Nowhere to be seen. Moving into our present days, we need to be very discerning when we see or hear reports of angels and divine intervention. Certainly we're in a time where more and more people manipulate the news to prove their own beliefs or their own side of the story. There are some people who think some of the reported UFOs might be angel sightings. We have reports from entire flight crews on commercial jets that describe phenomena that sounds an awful lot like some of the descriptions we have of angels in the Bible. How many of us have seen videos that purport to show angels hovering around an accident scene? Are they to be believed? Which ones are true? Which ones are just lighting anomalies? Have they been photoshopped? I think some of them are absolutely true. I also want to suggest an answer to the many reports of people exhibiting superhuman strength in the face of danger. You know, 130-pound woman lifting a car with a child. What if an angel was the one who came to the rescue? Is that also a plausible answer? I really don't know the statistics. It seems to me that most of those instances involve children. And we are told by scriptures that angels have a particular charge to look at the children. I truly believe that angels are still around us. You? They're God's messengers to us. They uplift us. They help guide us. Sometimes they even protect us. But there's still one important thing that we have to remember. As powerful as they are, angels do not spread the message of Jesus Christ to the world. Every story we hear about angels and how they help us here on earth does one thing. It shows the power and the love of God towards us. But that by itself is not spreading the word. Everyone who tells of their encounters with angels is helping to spread the word. Everyone who testifies to the glory of God and the salvation delivered through Jesus Christ is helping to spread the word. Angels are here to help us, but it is our responsibility as Christians to tell the world about Jesus and what he has done and continues to do in our lives. It's our responsibility to tell the world about our God of love. A God who loves us so much that he gave his only son to die for our sins. He also provided spiritual beings that are charged with ministering to us as we minister to the unsaved people in this world. Amen. Please stand.